Hello all. Good morning. Welcome to VTU eShikshana program. Myself, Dr. Vinay KB, Deputy Dean, Academic Affairs and Associate Professor of Mechanical Engineering from Vidyavardhaka College of Engineering, Mysore. Through this VTU eShikshana program, I'll be dealing with the course Elements of Mechanical Engineering, which is a common course for all the branch of engineering in the first year. I'll be taking you through Module 1. Module 1 covers the sources of energy, concepts of thermodynamics, and the steam and its properties. So let's go through the first module and the lesson 1, which deals with the sources of energy. So in this particular class or a lesson, you will be made to learn through the concepts of energy, what is the definition of energy, classification, and its sources. So these are the learning objective of lesson 1. So moving ahead, what is energy? So energy is very difficult to define and very hard to define, but most common definition of energy is the ability or the capacity to do work. Energy can be stored in various forms. Energy can be classified as kinetic energy, potential energy, and internal energy. So what is this kinetic energy, potential energy, and internal energy? So this energy which exists in various forms, if a body or a system possesses energy at rest, then we call it as potential energy. If a body or a system possesses energy during motion or during movement, then we call it as kinetic energy. Then what is internal energy? So internal energy is nothing but by chemical system by virtue of which the motions between the molecules and the atoms within the system is what we call it as internal energy. So whatever the energy we name it, either it has to be a kinetic energy or a potential energy or an internal energy. So kinetic energy, energy possessed during the movement or during the motion. Potential energy is the energy possessed when a system or a body is at rest. Internal energy is within the body or within the system due to the movement of atoms and molecules, then it releases some energy or exchange of energy takes place. So that is what we call it as internal energy. So when it comes to usage, we do use energy in various forms, maybe mechanical energy, thermal energy, chemical energy, electrical energy, radiant energy, and atomic energy. So we do use the energy in different forms in our day-to-day life. So this is the definition and the types of energy or the energy that is possessed by a system or a body and what are the various forms of energy which we use in our day-to-day life. Moving ahead, let us now discuss where are the sources from where we can derive the energy. So basically, we can classify the energy source. The source means from where we derive the energy, can be classified into capital energy and celestial or income energy. So what is the difference between capital energy and celestial or income energy? So capital energy is nothing but the energy that is possessed within the earth crust or that exists in the earth is what we call it as capital energy. And examples of capital energy are fossil fuels. As we are aware that within the earth crust, the fossil fuels are trapped. The petroleum is trapped, the coal is trapped, and the natural gas are trapped within the earth crust. So that exists within the earth crust. So it is a capital energy. Similarly, nuclear fuels like uranium. So it is being trapped inside the earth crust. And similarly, we can find some E-traps, so where we can see steam well, we can see hot water springs which are there being present within our earth crust. So these are some of the examples of capital energy, that is the energy that is stored within the earth crust. The other category of energy source is celestial or income energy. So what do you mean by celestial or income energy? It is nothing but the energy that comes from the outer space to the earth. So that is what we call it as celestial or income energy. Example, solar radiation. The sun emits radiations on earth. It comes from the outer space. So which we call it as electromagnetic radiation, or simply we can call it as photons. Similarly, gravitational attraction between the earth and moon, which results in tidal waves in the sea. So that is also an energy which makes the waves to go for high tide or a low tide due to the gravitational attraction between the earth and the moon. So that is also an energy which is coming from the outer space. Apart from that, so there are certain stars, planets and the moon which do emit certain particle energy. So which comes from the outer space. So celestial or income energy is nothing but the energy that comes from the outer space. So this is the basic classification of sources from where we can derive the energy. So moving ahead further, let us move on to what are the classification of energy we have. So classification means how can we classify the energy based on from where we derive it. So basically we classify that into primary energy and the secondary energy. So we will be concentrating only on the primary energy, because secondary energy by default it is an electricity. So electricity is not available as of now in the raw form. It has to be converted from some other form. Whereas primary energy is which is available in the raw form, which is available in the form from where we can derive it. Okay, so primary energy is further classified into renewable energy and non-renewable energy. So this renewable energy and non-renewable energy, these are the present terminologies. So earlier these were known as renewable energy were known as non-conventional energy sources, and non-renewable energy are known as conventional sources. What do you mean by conventional sources? It is also named as traditional, convention or tradition. It is nothing but we have been following a certain trend or a certain tradition or a certain convention which our ancestors were following. So ancestors, they were using coal, we are using it. They were using wood, we were using it. So that means to say we don't have any control on its production, but we just take it out as it exists, we take it out from the earth and we use it. So we are just following a convention or a tradition that was in practice long ago, and we have been continuing that. So that is what we call it as conventional sources or traditional sources, but in modern days we call it as non-renewable sources. Examples of such sources are the coal, oil, gas and the nuclear fuels. So which are existing in the earth crust. So that means to say the capital energy that is stored within the earth, like coal, oil or gas or the nuclear fuels, are basically the non-renewable or the conventional or the traditional source, which we don't have any control on its formation or production. On the other hand, we have the renewable energy, so which we term it as non-conventional sources. Non-conventional means something new we are coming out with. That means to say we are coming out with an alternative sources of energy, and which we call it as renewable sources. Examples of renewable energy sources are hydro, that is water, geothermal, that is earth do trap certain amount of heat in it in the form of steam or in the form of hot water, so that we can try tap it out and use it. Solar radiations, so that is also being trapped and used for various purposes. Wind energy is being used, tidal energy is also being used, and biomass is also being used nowadays. So this is a new trend or something non-conventional we have come out with, which we name it as a renewable energy sources. So the examples of renewable sources are solar, wind, tidal, biomass, hydro, as well as the geothermal energy conversion system. Okay, so this is how we basically classify the energy. So renewable energy system and non-renewable energy system. So why we have named it as renewable and non-renewable, and what are the differences of between this renewable sources and non-renewable sources? So let us move ahead and see what are the basic differences between the renewable source and the non-renewable sources. As the name says, renewable sources. What do you mean by renewable sources? So renewable sources means these are those energy resources which are produced continuously in nature and are essentially inexhaustible. Inexhaustible means which will never get what exhausted at all. So that means at least as for the time frame as the human society exists, that we can see. So renewable sources are nothing but those energy sources which are produced continuously or which are being used and which is inexhaustible. It doesn't get exhausted at all, at least in the time frame of the human society. Whereas on the other side, so solar, renewable means solar, wind, tidal, water, all those things will exist as long as the human society exists. And that is what we call it as inexhaustible sources. Whereas on the other end is the non-renewable energy sources, which we call it as conventional sources. They are exhaustible. We don't have any control over the production of or the formation of petrol or coal or the natural gas. And they are exhaustible. And these are those which are accumulated over the ages. We are not doing it. It is not artificially prepared. It is naturally available in the earth crust and it has been accumulated over years, over decades, and it cannot be quickly replenished. Replenished means replaced. So we don't have any alternative for that. So that's the reason we call non-renewable sources are exhaustible. It gets exhausted on continuous usage. That is the major difference between the renewable sources and non-renewable sources. One more difference is renewable sources, as I said, the solar radiations or the wind or the tides or the water, these are freely available in the nature. And moreover, those conversion process using those renewable sources are also environment friendly. It will not emit any carbon emissions. Whereas on the other hand, the conventional sources or the non-renewable sources like the oil, like petrol, natural gas and the coal, these are not freely available. It need to be taken out. It need to be extracted from the earth. It need to be processed. It need to be refined. Then it has to be used. And moreover, during this process of this refinement, it costs you more. And by the time it reaches you, so the cost of those fuels will be very high. And moreover, not only the cost of the fuel, it is also not environment friendly because it is polluting our environment a lot because of more carbon emissions. So that is one more difference between the renewable energy sources and the non-renewable energy. So one more is this, as I said, it is continuously available. Once it is continuously available, you can store it and utilize whenever you want. As long as the nature exists, as long as this earth exists, it is continuously available. Solar radiation will not be available every day. Yes, it's available. Wind will not be there. Yes, it will be there. Water, it will be there. And that is seasonal dependent. So as long as this human society exists, as long as this earth exists, there is a continuous supply of these energy sources, isn't it? Isn't it? So that is there. Whereas on the other side, non-renewable sources cannot be recovered. So once you dig it out, take it out and use it, done. It cannot be replenished. It cannot be recovered anymore. So these sources, once used, cannot be replenished or cannot be recovered. On the other hand, even though this renewable sources to convert from the available form to the required form. So solar radiation, we can't use it directly. So it has to be converted into electrical energy and use it. It has to be converted into heat energy and use it. Similarly, wind energy cannot be used directly. It has to be converted into mechanical energy and use it. So that means to say, this conversion process will cost you I initially. So that is initial cost for converting these energy sources and utilizing will be I. But down the lane, its maintenance cost is low. Its maintenance cost is low. Whereas on the other side, if I want to depend on the non-renewable sources, its initial cost is also high as well as maintenance cost is high. Because I need to find such place in the earth crust, I need to go down, dig it, mining, you have to go for mining, extract that, then you have to refine it, then you have to transport it, then you have to use it. So all this process will be very high, and not only that, even the maintenance cost of such equipment which uses these non-renewable sources are also high. And one more difference is this energy availability in the renewable sources is continuous though, but intermittent. Why we call it as intermittent means these are all season dependent. So even though the sun is available every day, but the intensity varies depending on the season. Its intensity varies depending on the position on earth. Oh, based on the intensity, obviously the energy supply will also be intermittent. Similarly, water will not be available throughout the year. So it is also season dependent. So it is available, renewable, but not continuous. Okay, so the supply of energy or the energy that can be converted from these renewable sources is intermittent in nature, and therefore we can't expect continuous supply of energy from these purpose. Whereas there on the other side, like oil, petroleum products, like oil, natural gas and the coal, it is continuously available as long as it exists in the earth crust. Okay, so these are the basic differences between the renewable sources and the non-renewable sources. But at present, we are more depending on the renewable sources rather than non-renewable sources, because a time has come where these non-renewable sources are, we are in a phase where these sources are getting exhausted. So that's the reason we are now concentrating and we are switched over from non-renewable sources to renewable sources. So these are the basic differences between the renewable and non-renewable sources. Whether it is renewable or non-renewable, where do you apply? Basically, in most of the application, it is finally the secondary energy source what we make use, that is electricity, isn't it? If you want a light in your house, you need electricity. If you want to switch on an AC, we need electricity. If you want to switch on a fan, we need an electricity, isn't it? Finally, in the present generation, we make use of secondary energy source, that is the electricity. That means to say, whether it is renewable energy sources or non-renewable energy sources, everything need to be converted finally into a secondary energy source, which is an electrical energy. So there are different types of energy from where we can convert the primary into secondary. So fossil fuels, we can convert that primary into secondary. How? Primary is what? It's a fossil fuel, which is basically a chemical energy, which need to be converted into mechanical energy. Mechanical energy in turn will be converted into electrical energy. Similarly, if you take a idle water, so there also we'll be converting energy possessed by the water into mechanical energy, then mechanical energy into finally the secondary energy source, electrical energy. If you take solar, so solar radiation, so using that we'll be making use of solar cells. So finally we are converting solar energy or photons into electrical energy. Wind, so energy possessed by the wind, which is nothing but the kinetic energy, wind energy, will be converted into mechanical energy, in turn finally into electrical energy. So whatever you take, even the nuclear fuels is also same. So nuclear fuels are basically used to heat water. So water will be converted into steam. The steam is used to run the steam turbine. The steam turbine will give you mechanical energy. Mechanical energy will be finally converted into secondary energy source, which is nothing but electrical. So whatever the energy source, whether you go for renewable energy source or non-renewable energy source, so finally the major utilization of these sources are in the form of electrical energy. Okay, so final application of these energy sources will be the secondary energy source, which is an electrical energy. So we will discuss one by one. So first I'll be moving on to the conventional sources. So conventional means non-renewable energy sources. So under non-renewable energy sources, we will be discussing the fossil fuels. So fossil fuels means the formation of petrol, the formation of coal and the formation of natural gas. So how these fossil fuels are used for conversion of energy from the existing form to the required form. So that we will discuss first. So first we'll cover all the conventional sources and then we'll move on to all the non-conventional or renewable sources. So first, under conventional or non-renewable sources, we will deal with the fossil fuels. So fossil fuels means, fossil means earth. The fuels that are existing in the earth crust is what we call it as fossil fuels. So what are fuels? These are basically a material that possess energy in its that possess energy at rest, isn't it? That is nothing but the potential energy. These are the fuels. Basically, fuels possess energy in the form of potential energy. So unless and until if it is not ignited, it will not release you heat energy. Petrol, it need to be ignited. Natural gas, it need to be ignited. Coal, it need to be ignited. Unless, that means to say, it possess energy, but it is at rest. Unless and until if it is not ignited, it will not release the energy possessed by it. So it is an energy possessed at rest. So the fuels, we can say that it possess potential energy in it. So it need to be ignited and it releases energy in the form of heat. Okay. So when it comes to fuel, we can classify the fuels as natural and artificial. So natural are primary fuels. So natural primary means which are naturally formed in the earth. Artificial or secondary fuels are those which we artificially prepare in the laboratory, like biofuels, which we have been using nowadays. So these are artificially made fuels. So we will be discussing only the natural or the primary fuel in this particular class. So we'll move on to the formation of the natural fuels. So first let us discuss the solid fuel. So naturally available solid fuel example is what? Wood and coal, or in general we just call it as charcoal. Okay, so those charcoals are available in various forms depending on the quality or depending on the grade of the coal. So normally the charcoals are available in three grades. The one what we call it as a peat, the second grade is what we call it, the lowest grade is the peat. So moderate grade is the bituminous coal, and the fine and the high grade coal is the anthracite. Okay, so apart from that, wood also is a naturally available solid fuel which we have been using for ages. Okay, so I'll tell you about the formation of solid fuel, that is especially the charcoal. So how these coals are formed? See, coals is a solid fuel which is formed from the ancient plants like trees, ferns and mosses. So that all those big trees and all those things after their life, or if we just chop it off and leave it aside. So obviously these dead plants or the dead trees or the ferns, mosses, all these things that are being dumped across the coastal line. So you know that all these waste matters are normally dumped across the coastal line. In the coastal line, you know that it is a seawater. And the mud of those sea is also salt mud. That means to say, those mud that is there across the coastal line are basically an organic rich mud. Why it is organic rich mud? Because it contains salt or sodium in it, isn't it? So once we dump all these dead plants, trees or ferns, mosses across the coastal line, so it undergoes a decay process. Obviously, it mixes with organic rich mud across the coastal line, right? Like that, we keep on dumping every now and then, and every now this undergoes a decay, decay, and then it undergoes mixes with the organic rich mud, and like that, a layer by layer is formed one above the other. So it takes ages, it will not happen overnight. It takes ages or decades together, where a layer of all this decayed solid matters after mixing with the organic rich mud forms. So over that one more layer forms, over that one more layer, like that layer is formed one above the other. When n number of layers are formed one above the other, the layers down, the layers which are at the bottom, they are being subjected to high pressure, isn't it? As the layer grows, so the lower layers will be subjected to high pressure. And moreover, it is at the coastal line, so temperature will be very high enough. So due to this high pressure and high temperature, those at the lower layers will undergo a transition state and it starts getting converted, especially these trees, ferns, mosses and plants which are huge enough, it gets it undergoes a transitional state and slowly it gets converted into a coal. And during this formation of coal, it does exist in three different forms. So initially it is what we call it as a peat. So why it is called as a peat? Because it has not been completely converted into a coal. It is still having a water content in it. Still it has got a plant matter present in it. That means to say hydrocarbon is less in percentage and more of plant matter or water content in it. That is the reason we call it as peat, and it is not completely a coal, and it is a low grade coal. Even if you burn it, will not get the required energy. If you allow it for some more time, it will still undergo a transitional state, and thereby the peat gets converted into bituminous coal. That means to say, if you just allow it to decay for some more years, what happens? The water matter gets decreased and the hydrocarbon matter gets increased and gets converted into a second grade or moderate grade of coal, which we call it as the bituminous coal. If we leave it further for few more years, still it undergoes a decay process or a transitional state. So where again more it will become more rich in hydrocarbon and very 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 less or lowest moisture, what we can say. And that is the fine grade or the highest grade of coal, which we call it as anthracite, which has got the higher percentage of hydrocarbon, nil or very less or lowest moisture or water content in it. Okay, that is how the coals are formed. So coals are basically formed from all the dead plants, okay, trees, you are using those big branches and all those things. So once we dump across the coastline, so it mixes with organic rich mud and then it undergoes this chemical reaction process. That is how the coal are formed. Moving on to this liquid fuel, the formation of liquid fuel after refinery, we just classify that as petrol, kerosene, diesel, alcohol and mineral oil, like that we categorize it. Basically it's a crude oil which is being formed naturally in the earth crust. So how that crude oil or the petroleum is formed, the process is very much similar to that of coal. What is that? Only the ingredient is different. What are the ingredient that forms the petroleum? It is nothing but the microscopic plants and the bacteria. See, these microscopic plants and the dead bacteria, obviously it is dumped across the coastline along with these trees and all those things. So those small microscopic plants and the dead bacteria, it also mixes with the organic rich mud across the coastal line, right? So once it mixes with the organic, similar to that of a coal, there also a layer of organic rich mud is there, which is having dead bacteria and microscopic plant in it. Next, one more layer is formed. Over that, one more layer is formed. Like that, it takes years and ages together to form one layer over the other. And as the layers increases, the lower layers are being subjected to high temperature and high pressure. And as it being subjected to high temperature and high pressure because of this accumulation of layers one above the other, so these are compressed into shales and thereby it transforms that, and thereby a petroleum or an oil oozes out of those shells, and that is what we call it as petroleum. That is how this liquid fuel, the petroleum, is formed, or nothing but the crude form. Petroleum in the crude form is formed. The only ingredients are different. All these fossil fuels will undergo the same transitional phase. Only the ingredients are different. If it trees, big trees, trunks, ferns, mosses, then it becomes a coal. It is small microscopic plants or the dead bacteria, then obviously it will ooze out a liquid, and that is nothing but your petroleum in the crude form. And finally, one more thing is what? The natural gas. So natural gas, as you know, it is nothing but the methane, so which can be converted into other forms and being used now. So we will be discussing only the gas, that is natural gas, that is formed in the earth crust. So even this also undergoes the same process, what only the ingredients are different. So natural gas are basically formed from the tiny water dwelling organisms like algae and protozoans. So in general we just call it as planktons. So all these planktons like algae and protozoans, these dead plants, planktons and algae, they also go and settle there at the across the coastal line. Just like once we dump all these things, algae will be dumped, the protozoans will be dumped, the microscopic plants will be dumped, the bacteria will be there, big trees, trunks will be there. Only based on the process, based on the ingredient, it is being converted into either coal or the petrol or the natural gas. So here, the natural gas, the ingredient is the tiny water dwelling organisms like algae and protozoans. So the process is same. These algae and protozoans, they mix with organic rich mud across the coastal line. They settle down like that. Every now and then a layer is formed one above the other. It takes ages together to form n number of layers. Those layers which are at the bottom are being subjected to high temperature and pressure. So due to this high temperature and pressure, it undergoes a transitional state of chemical reaction whereby those algae and the protozoans will ooze a gas, will ooze out a gas. And that gas is nothing but your natural gas, which is nothing but the methane. Okay, so ingredients vary, but the process will happen at the same place because we are not segregating everything and dumping there. We'll just dump everything. All the natural waste are dumped across the coastal line. If it is algae and protozoans, it undergoes a transformation phase and oozes out a gas. If it is bacteria and small plants, then it gives you or it oozes out the oil or the petroleum. If it is big trunks or trees or ferns and mosses, it slowly undergoes and gets converted itself into a coal. And during coal formation, it might be low grade to high grade, from peat to bituminous, from bituminous to anthracite. So this is how the fossil fuel means the fuels that are formed within the earth crust. If it is solid fuel, coal is formed. If it's a liquid fuel, the petroleum is formed. If it's a gaseous fuel, it is the natural gas which is formed. So whatever the fuel you take petroleum or the natural gas or the coal, all of them possess energy. But all those energy are potential energy. Unless and until if it is not ignited, it will not release the energy possessed by these fossil fuels. So what to do that? So in order to extract energy from these fossil fuels, it has to undergo a combustion. So what do you mean by combustion? Combustion is nothing but igniting the fuel. How can you ignite the fuel? The fuel need to be ignited in the presence of oxygen. So fuel plus oxygen, if you ignite, so automatically it will release you huge amount of energy. So that means energy is released in the form of heat energy. And that heat energy can be used and converted into some other form. Okay. So normally this petroleum or the coal or the natural gas, basically it undergoes a combustion process in the presence of oxygen and releases enormous amount of heat energy. That heat energy in turn is used to run either a turbine or an engine, so whereby we get mechanical energy. So mechanical energy in turn can be converted into electrical energy. So whatever it might be, all these fossil fuels are basically a combustible fuels, or it has to undergo a combustion. Once it undergoes a combustion, elements like carbon and hydrogen are present in this, because these fuels are very rich in hydrocarbon. So it has to undergo a combustion process in the presence of oxygen. And once it undergoes a combustion process, it releases enormous amount of heat energy, which can be converted into mechanical energy using turbines and engines. So which in turn can be converted into electrical energy by using generators. But when it undergoes a combustion process, it not only releases heat energy, it also releases some products, what we call it as products of combustion or the remains of the combustion process. Before deciding on the remains of combustion process, I'll tell you, if you want to ensure maximum amount of heat is released from these fossil fuels, it has to be mixed with an air with a proper proportion. So that is what we call it as air fuel ratio. So air as well as the fuel which we are intending to burn should be mixed in a proper proportion. Even if I go for excess fuel mixture, that means to say more of fuel, less of oxygen, then we call it as too rich mixture. Then also that results in incomplete combustion. Even if I go for excess of air and less of fuel, then we call it as too lean mixture. Then also it results in incomplete combustion. So there is a proper ratio which need to be maintained between the air and the fuel to ensure complete combustion takes place, and we will be able to trap maximum amount of energy, that to heat energy, from this combustion process. Okay, so fuel and oxygen need to be mixed in proper proportion and ignited, burnt. So automatically heat energy is released. Not only heat energy is released, it will release the products, certain products of combustion. So what are those products of combustion, or what we call it as the remains of the burnt gases? So these fuel, once you burn, obviously the remains is what we call it as burnt gases. So these burnt gases will leave you some products. So those are known as products of combustion. What does it leave back? It normally leaves, there is nothing but the pollutants. It is nothing but the pollutants. If I burn a petrol, it releases, the burnt gases releases various pollutants, which are nothing but the products of combustion. If I burn a coal, it releases ash, and that ash contains various products of combustion. What does it possess? All these fossil fuels or the natural fuels, once it undergoes a combustion process, it releases carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, sulfur dioxide, water, nitrogen oxide, lead, and particulate matter. These are, they might be varying in various proportions. Okay, majority will be carbon monoxide only. So whereas nitrogen, lead, and particulate matter will be in less percentage. So major proportion of products of combustion is carbon monoxide. And these are having a cascading effect on our environment. Okay, so that we'll discuss as we move ahead in the next session. But what are the products? Normally carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, sulfur oxide, water, nitrogen, lead, and other particulate matters are the remains or the products of the combustion process. So these are present in the burnt gases. Okay, that is the products. So, and apart from that, as I said, it is the heat energy which we are recovering from the combustion of these fossil fuels. So once we recover the heat, that heat energy is in turn converted into mechanical, and we are using it. So how do we find what is the energy released by that particular fuel? How can I calculate the energy? What is the amount of energy that is released by burning the coal, by burning petrol, by burning natural gas? How do we find that? So that can be found, and that can be found, and that is what we call it as calorific value. So calorific value is nothing but finding out, or the value that determines what is the quantity or the amount of heat released when it undergoes the combustion process by unit mass or unit volume of a fuel. What is the amount of heat liberated when I burn 1 kg of coal? That is calorific value. What is the amount of heat released when if I burn 1 liter of petrol? That is calorific value. What is the amount of heat released if I burn 1 meter cube of natural gas? That is what we call it as a calorific value. That is the amount of heat released per unit mass of the fuel being completely burnt. And under this we have two calorific values. One is what we call it as higher calorific value, or in general we call it as gross calorific value, and the other one is the lower or net calorific value. So what do you mean by this? So higher or gross calorific value is the maximum. I can just, to be very simply, to put it in a simple term, I can just say it as maximum amount of energy that can be released by the fuel. But whatever the heat that is being released by the fuel cannot be completely utilized or cannot be completely converted into mechanical energy. isn't it? A few of that is lost because the burnt gases itself will take away some heat. The products of combustion will take away some heat. So after all the losses, whatever the heat that is actually available for us to use is what we call it as lower calorific value or the net calorific value. So any system will definitely have any losses. Even here, if I burn the fuel, whatever the total energy that is possessed by a fuel will not be completely available for us to use. So that is what we call it as availability is what IR or the gross calorific value. After subtracting all the losses, what is actually available for us is what we call it as lower calorific value or the net calorific value. Got it? So, fossil fuel, it cannot be used in the existing form because it possesses energy in the form of a potential energy. So, it need to be converted by combustion process. If it undergoes a combustion process in the presence of oxygen, it liberates huge amount of heat that can be having higher calorific value or lower calorific value, that then the products of the combustion. Okay, so now let me summarize what all we have covered under lesson 1 of module 1. So I did introduce you to the definition of energy, what are the sources from where we can derive the energy, what are the forms of energy, and how do can we classify the energy like renewable and non-renewable, and what are the examples of renewable sources and what are the examples of non-renewable sources, what are the differences between the renewable and non-renewable sources. Then we took up only non-renewable sources or the conventional sources, where I just took the fossil fuels. We discussed about the formation of these fossil fuels, that is fuels which are available in the earth crust. So how the solid fuel, that is the coal, is formed, how the liquid fuel, that is petroleum, is formed, how the gaseous fuel, that is natural gas, formed, how these fuels can be used to convert into other forms. So these fuels can be converted to other form by fuel combustion. If we want to undergo a combustion process, these fuels need to be mixed with air and has to undergo a combustion process, thereby releasing enormous amount of heat, and that heat energy can be converted into mechanical, and mechanical energy can be in turn converted into electrical energy. And finally, we did discuss, once this fuel undergoes a combustion process, it releases the byproducts or the products of the combustion or the remains of those burnt gases, as well as how do we determine the energy content of the fuel. The energy content of the fuel is determined by the calorific value. There also we discussed what is higher calorific value and lower calorific value. That is all for lesson 1. We'll see you on again for lesson 2. Thank you.